We tend to have a few here. So there's a really tiny one there. There's one here, one there. And then on the trunk, there's one here, another one here, here.
This is CrowdScience from the BBC World Service, the show that answers your pressing science questions.
Here, another here.
Meet listener Alexandre, who's showing you around his garden, where the main crop he seems to be growing are snails.
Yeah, I've collected, I think, around 2,000 snails in total. Because every time it rains, they all seem to come out. It's like, where were you hiding? I'd picked up everything and there are more. They just seem to keep coming.
I'm Marnie Chesterton, and my tiny meter of garden also has a snail problem. It feels good to commiserate with a fellow sufferer.
On top of the rocks, it was completely covered with flowers. In a week, everything disappeared. They ate all the flowers, all the leaves.
And all the stalks, so you've just got these tiny white stumps left.
All gone.
Presumably you didn't just get in touch to compare notes on snail damage. What's your question for CrowdScience?
So I have a question about snails. I've been trying to figure out how to get rid of them if there was any predator I could have maybe in my garden. But I haven't seen anything that seemed to be effective. So I've wondered, what are snails actually good for, if anything at all, in nature, in the environment? Would nature miss them if they disappeared?
I love this question because it's not just how can I get rid of this problem in my garden. At a certain point, it turns philosophical. Like, what is the point of this species? You're also thinking big ecological picture.
Yeah, it makes you wonder if there is any species that doesn't necessarily contribute to the environment. Like, is there anything for which we haven't been able to explain their role in maintaining life balance on the Earth?
Which does get philosophical because each individual from that species is a life in itself. But what you're asking about is how useful is that life in maintaining other lives?
Yes. Because then if it ever comes into danger of extinction, how concerned would we be? Would it be because we think we should preserve life no matter how useful it is? Yeah, that's turning pretty philosophical.
We're not afraid to tackle philosophy on CrowdScience. And Alexander's deceptively simple question about snails is actually a portal into huge questions about the value of life on our planet. We often hear how important biodiversity is, and about totemic species like elephants and gorillas. But ecosystems are staggeringly complex, and we'll only begin to understand them by studying creatures like the small and unloved snail. Talking of which, I want to find out more about my gardening nemesis. Where does this snail like to hang out? Apart from on my lettuce leaves.
So this is oakwood, which is one of the oldest parts of the garden. It's also a bit more shady and a bit more damp, so it's the best place to find snails here at Wisley.
CrowdScience has come to Wisley Gardens, run by UK gardening charity, the Royal Horticultural Society. It's a world of different gardening styles, and we walk past beds of colourful flowers basking in the dazzling sunshine. But we're headed for the shady undergrowth with a snail expert.
My name's Imogen Cavadino. I am researching slugs and snails in UK gardens.
I imagine when you tell people that you study slugs and snails, gardeners ask you, how do they get rid of them? So or they tell you their complaints.
Oh, all the time, yes. Slugs and snails are usually one of the top 10 inquired about pests in the garden, unfortunately.
As we walk through woodland, it's not long before Imogen spots some suspiciously hole-filled leaves on a hosta, one of the garden snail's favourite plants.
There's even poop on the leaf.
Oh, is that snail poo?
Yeah.
I'm learning. That's my new thing for today. You were drawn to these leaves because half of them are missing. Can you look at these and go, yeah, snails did that?
Well, we could tell you that it's slug or snail, but to find out which one for sure, we'd have to actually see the culprit in action.
Shall we have a hunt around and see if we can find
one? Yeah, let's have a little rummage. Here we go. The snail we've even been looking for. So this is the common garden snail.
That looks a lot like the ones that I pick off my sweet peas in my tiny garden.
So this species is really widespread across all of Britain. It was thought to actually be introduced by the Romans, who farm snails for food. So this is quite a popular one to eat historically. So originally it came from the Mediterranean area, so it's adapted to quite a warm climate. But what makes this so successful is it seems to be able to adapt to also very cold extremes and some hot extremes as well. So these are really successful invaders of a lot of countries in North America, South America, Australia, and all across Europe as well. And it is considered a major pest in a lot of countries.
Imogen is holding up a pretty brown spiral shell, about 3 centimetres in diameter. Meet Cornu aspersum, the common garden snail. This is the species causing our listener Alexandre some problems. Do they do anything helpful, or are they just a pest?
It can do a lot of damage to our garden plants. During the spring, it will go for a lot of young, tender plant material. But in the autumn, around this time of year, it seems to switch to more decaying plant material, so things like the dead leaves and all the vegetation that's dying back. So at that point, it is our friend because it's helping break those nutrients down back into the soil.
So they could be really helpful in your compost heap?
Definitely, yeah. The challenge is keeping them there and stopping them from going to the rest of the plants in your garden.
So we can award this pest some ecosystem points for nutrient recycling. And as we rooted around for more snails, we hit on another benefit.
Oh, there's a really big one.
Hooray! Oh no, it's an empty shell. Oh, that's a shame. So this is the shell of a common garden snail again.
What happened to the inhabitant?
It may have just died of old age, or it may have been eaten by a predator. Snails do have a lot of predators. Birds in particular are quite reliant on snails as a source of calcium. They need that calcium to produce their eggs. But also a huge range of different invertebrates will feed on snails. So one we actually have present at Wisley is a glowworm, which is actually a type of beetle despite its name. And the larvae of that beetle bite the snail and inject a venom, and then they'll just ride around on the shell until the venom paralyzes the snail, and then come back down and feed on the soft fleshy parts of the living snail. It's a bit gruesome.
Gruesome, but if you're not a fan of snails, then maybe encouraging glowworms and birds into your garden might be helpful.
Yes, definitely. A whole range of wildlife, really. It's all about trying to get that healthy balance of a good ecosystem in the garden. So encouraging all the wildlife to come in as your natural predators who will feed on slugs and snails as part of their diet.
So if they're part of our ecosystem, this is a judgment call, but are they a legitimate part? Because if the Romans brought them over, aren't they an invasive species?
There's always a tricky one when it comes to this particular species, because it is an example of one that's been moved around by humans. So they've been here for over 2,000 years at this point, so our ecosystem has adapted to include them.
Though if they were to suddenly disappear, would we notice problems in the ecosystem?
I'm pretty sure we would. It's always difficult to predict because you never know what other animals may come in to fill those niches, but also we just don't know exactly every function that snails perform. But we would expect maybe to see a decline in the bird population. We may also start seeing a lot more dead things around, so things like dead animals, dead plant material. But that's quite difficult to say for certain as well, because there's a large number of different insects and invertebrates that will also eat those things. So it's possible that they will just move in and take over those functions. But we just would never know for sure, thankfully, because snails are here to stay.
You say that happily. Can I ask how you feel about snails?
I think they're absolutely fascinating and they're quite beautiful. They're used a lot in various cultures for artwork and jewellery and architecture. So a lot of inspiration to people, the humble snail.
So far, we've focused on the common garden snail, but it's just one of more than 100 species of land snails in the UK. Worldwide, there are tens of thousands of species, all doing their own thing. So really, we need to think about them too if we're going to understand what role snails play in nature. And where better to go than one of the world's snail diversity hotspots?
The Hawaiians had a reverence for these mountain snails, these land snails, and they were thought to be singing after a rainstorm, you know, listen to the snail sing. They were thought to hold some sort of very highly spiritual significance.
That's Dr. Noreen Jung, malacology curator at the Bishop Museum on the Hawaiian island of Oahu. Malacology is the study of mollusks, including the more than 750 species of land snails native to Hawaii. Until relatively recently, these snails decorated the landscape in huge numbers.
There were a lot of observations of the collectors back in the days that they were so abundant that they were like grapes ripe for the picking off of trees. So you can imagine how many there were just hanging off a single leaf, you know, like clusters of grapes. And now you'd be lucky to find one or even a handful in certain valleys.
Today, native Hawaiian snails are incredibly endangered, and the Bishop Museum has a team of volunteers painstakingly caring for them here.
If we walk to this other room here, you'll see the captive rearing facility. We are trying to safeguard them in these little boxes, or what we call lifeboats. In this box here, we have a snail that we actually rediscovered back in 2008. It was about to be extinct. So Kaala sabritia is a beautiful spirally snail. It looks like a cinnamon bun, golden splotches against black splotches. But the shell is actually translucent. The coloration comes from the body. So you would never know how beautiful this snail is unless it was alive. So in the captive rearing facility, we are keeping 20 or so species alive and hoping that we can eventually reintroduce them into the wild.
So right now we are headed north on the island of Oahu, and we're barely just able to see the summit of Mount Kaala, the highest point on the island of Oahu. It's at about 4,000.
Mount Kaala is one of the places the snails from the museum's lifeboats are reintroduced. It lends its name to the species of snail that Noreen just described as a living cinnamon bun.
You can see Mount Kaala is just sort of shrouded in clouds.
My ears just popped.
Yeah, you can definitely tell the pressure difference.
CrowdScience reporter Savannah Harriman-Pote joined several of Noreen's colleagues on a trip to one of the native snail's few remaining habitats, high up in the mountains.
It's getting a little chilly.
Yeah, the temperature's dropped.
Savannah's guide is Dr. Ken Hayes, director of the Pacific Center for Molecular Biodiversity at Bishop Museum.
We're probably at about 30.
Ken and his team are researching these snails and their mountain habitats.
We're going to go up here to the entrance to the bog and check it out.
This is Megan, Bonnie, and Jan.
Hi, nice to meet you.
All members of our snailing slash research crew. So here we are at the entrance to the Natural Area Reserve, or the NARS, as you'll hear us refer to it. The NARS system, it's hundreds of thousands of acres of land across the islands that are designated as these preserves to try to help save some of the wildlife and the ecosystems of Hawaii that we rely on.
And there's a fence that separates us right now from the formal Mount Kaala Area Reserve.
So shall we?
It's like we've stepped into another world. There's this narrow boardwalk surrounded on both sides by lush plants, and the sound of trickling water and the wind in the broadleafed olapa tree. And the mist hangs in the air, mixed with this sweet smell of the forest.
Remember this mountain, this habitat, what we're seeing built up over millions of years.
When do you think the snails got here?
We think at least 3 to 5 million years.
It's a good chunk of time.
It's a very long chunk of time. In Hawaii, we always say, you know, things get here by wind, wings, or water. So they either flew here. Snails don't fly, except on birds. So they can get stuck to birds. So we think that's how some of them got here. Our best estimate is we have about 23 colonization events. That means the more than 750 species we have here are the result of 23 successful colonizations. They took hold and were able to radiate in the islands, which, if you think about it, it's just extraordinary, right? I mean, we're out here in the middle of the Pacific. Imagine a tiny little snail, right, making it here, surviving, and then radiating into the spectacular diversity. It's an incredible story.
Ken and fellow snail expert Dave Sisto are here to check up on the descendants of the snails that made it here all those millions of years ago. But they're not always that easy to spot.
That's an adult snail.
That's a poppy seed.
Yeah, it's about the size of a poppy seed.
I'm just marveling at the fact that you saw something of that size on the underside of a leaf just as we were walking by. Do you have the best snail eye?
Well, I don't know. You do it long enough.
I'm going to try and spot my own snail.
All right.
It's like a little scavenger hunt. Oh, yes, I see one.
All right, you're hired.
My name is David Sisko, and I am a wildlife biologist with the Department of Land and Natural Resources, and I coordinate the Snail Extinction Prevention Program.
Gosh, this is just, I mean, I grew up on Big Island, and I had a lot of opportunity to go to native forests, but I never even considered snails as a component of that forest.
Yeah, it's really unfortunate. I think most people's interactions with snails are with them being garden pests. And really the vast majority of snails across the world are not garden pests. Invertebrates in general are the drivers of a lot of ecosystem function, and they're really critical for our survival and for ecosystem survival across the world.
The worrying thing is these little creatures are fading away fast. Ken is particularly concerned about one of the snail species they're here to look out for.
I'm just doing spot checks for Auriculella along the way. We're having a harder and harder time. Like, we find one or two, we're lucky, whereas we used to find dozens.
Populations that we've monitored and that have been monitored for the past 20 or 30 years, and we're seeing them just blink out right in front of our eyes, and it's very sad.
You got something good for me?
Snail sex, which is good to see, right?
We're all about snail baby making up here.
Exactly. We like to see snail baby making. Here's another native plant, right? And you can see a little bit of snail poop. So you look at these leaves, right? So you can see this black fungus on here and all of this white sooty stuff. So there's lots of microfilm growing on this. And what the snails are doing is they're going along this and they're scraping all of that off. And then they're pooping it out, and then the rain washes it down. And it provides fertilizer and nutrients that are so limiting in most of Hawaii's ecosystems, particularly nitrogen. And so one study by a colleague of ours, Marty Meyer, he excluded snails and other macroinvertebrates in a native forest and found that nitrogen turnover was reduced by 40%. So they're critical to maintaining ecosystems, right? Our native plants probably can't survive as well without our native invertebrates that they evolved with. Mm. But you can see here's another one right here. So this is a beautiful reddish brown succinaid right there. I'm always amazed at how absolutely beautiful they are, especially when you just take the time to look at them really closely. And this snail is just sort of lightly grazing on fungus.
And the snails back in Bishop Museum need this fungus too, which is why Jan K. Aloha is here.
We're going to collect some different native food plants for our snails we have in captive rearing. Just looking at all of these different ohia leaves, I'm trying to find the ones that have a good biofilm community on them, so the more black sooty mold that's on them, the better, because then there's actually something for our snails to crawl on and munch on.
Nice.
Yeah.
Good meal plan they got over at the museum.
Yes, definitely. Our snail overlords have beckoned us to go and get their food.
It's funny to think of black sooty mold as an appealing lunch.
Oh, it's like a buffet, I think, because black sooty mold is made out of who knows how many different things.
Why is this place important to the work you do?
This is our goal. Our goal is to get our snails in captive rearing back out into the forest where they naturally belong and let them do their jobs in the forest.
Researchers think that this diet of sooty fungus Jan and Ken described is one of the key reasons these snails are so important to the ecosystem here. Back at the museum, Ken told me why.
Here in Hawaii, snails, the native ones, tend to not eat plants, which is kind of unusual, and people are often surprised to find out.
That is surprising, because that is what everyone hates them for over in my country.
And that's often what they're known for around the world. But not all snails do that. The vast majority of the snails don't eat plants here. We like to call them the microfauna farmers of the forest. They consume bacteria, fungi, algae, things like that, on the surface of leaves of plants. And while we don't have hard evidence that this is a really important function, anecdotally, if you talk to people that have worked on snails for 50 plus years here in Hawaii, they will tell you that as the snails have declined, they've noticed an increase in this soot that grows on the native plants. And we've speculated that this probably has an impact on the plant's ability to photosynthesize, how it produces the energy it needs to grow. And in Hawaii, our plants evolved on an island without much competition. And so in modern times, we have a lot of non-native plants that have been introduced. There's been a lot of habitat destruction. And so as the native plants are reduced in number, and then they're less able to photosynthesize and grow competitively, the non-native plants start to take over.
So I'm getting a sense of these beautiful indigenous plants, and part of what keeps them successfully existing are these snails. So you take the snails out, and then the native plants do less well, which means that invasive species can take over.
Yeah, I mean, that's part of the puzzle, we think. It's really complex. You know, a lot of pieces that we don't understand. And that's one of the things our team's doing is trying to figure out all of these intricacies of how the snails, the plants, the insects, all of the flora and fauna interact with one another to create this sort of unique systems that we have in Hawaii.
Why is it important to know more about this?
The snails in Hawaii are highly endangered. As a matter of fact, snails throughout the Pacific are probably one of the most impacted groups of animals in the world. Snails account for nearly half of all recorded animal extinctions in the world since 1500. And most of those are on Pacific islands. And we are likely to lose the remaining few hundred within the next decade if we don't do something to save them.
So the local plants depend on the local snails, and the picture of the local snails is looking pretty bleak. In Hawaii, this is down to the usual enemies of biodiversity: habitat destruction, climate change, and invasive species, including other faster-growing snails.
The most notorious is Euglandina rosea, or the rosy wolf snail, a predatory snail that was introduced in an effort to control another introduced species, the giant African snail.
Oh, you're joking.
No. I wish I were. It seems like a joke. People go, that can't be real. And it is. It's somebody took and brought a snail from Florida to control a snail from Africa. And it didn't work, obviously.
Yeah.
They shipped over 120, I think, live in the 1950s. And when they arrived, they bred them up and they released tens of thousands of these things all over the islands. And there is no evidence that they had any impact on the giant African snail at all. But what they did do is they spread to the native forest and they consumed native snails. Like, you wouldn't believe how many some of these things can eat. I once found Euglandina, and I dissected it, and I found 52 snails in its stomach.
Oh.
So it had consumed 52 snails at one sitting. And so if you imagine 10,000 of those, each eating 50 snails at a sitting, it's devastating.
Part of the work to try and save Hawaiian snails involves a battle against these predators.
We ready to go down snail closure?
Ready.
Several snail exclosures have been established in Hawaii, fortresses to repel unwanted invaders. Back on Mount Ka'ala, Ken's colleague David Sisko gives us a tour of one.
The fence units are really our only way to preserve these animals in situ when they're under severe predation threat. Many of our larger snails, they only make 1 to 5 babies a year, so really low reproductive rates. So any depredation that's going on severely impacts their populations. And so these fence units allow us to wall off a certain portion of snail habitat, and they thrive inside because nothing's eating them.
Can you describe what we're looking at?
A solid wall fence that's about head high. At the very top, there is a curved hood, and that keeps rats and Jackson's chameleons from climbing up and over it. On the bottom of the fence, there's 3 barriers. One is a skirt that goes around the entire perimeter of the fence. Euglandina rosea go under that flange and they get stuck. If they do happen to make it over that, there's upside down cut copper wire mesh. But if they get past that, we electrocute them.
Very thorough.
They're a fortress. The size of a habitat you can protect with one of these is pretty small, but you can protect thousands of snails inside of these. This is us circling the wagons. This is going to be the only place in the coming future where snails are going to exist on this mountain. That sounds terribly gloomy, but the snail populations around the mountain are just declining so fast that this is how we're able to keep them alive.
Have you successfully released any captive snails back into the wild?
Yeah, so we, just this past year, we successfully released over 6,000 snails during a pandemic, so that's pretty cool.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Is it enough to turn the tide?
We are starting to turn the tide. We've taken species from being on the very brink of extinction to having multiple populations and now having wild counterparts. And so that's a slam dunk in my mind, because that species is not going to go extinct anymore, at least in the near term.
And high up on the side of this mountain, outside of this snail fortress, we contemplate the meaning of snails.
So it all started with the question from the listener that said, do snails matter? Well, yeah, they matter an absolutely enormous amount, you know, scientifically, ecologically, and culturally, and people don't leave having experienced them either in captivity or up here without feeling some sort of deep, moving sensation of like really wanting somehow to help.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I walked into the forest today having really no understanding of snails in Hawaii, and I walked out of the forest with a snail on me, so...
They do stick to you like that, right? Both physically and metaphorically, they stick with you.
The native snails in Hawaii give a sense of what an interdependent puzzle this environment is. You can't begin to assess what role the snails have in this ecosystem without also looking at everything they evolved alongside. The loss of a plant might trigger the loss of a snail, or vice versa, and that might set off a whole load of other consequences. And humans have a famously poor track record of predicting what those might be. So should we even attempt to answer the second part of Alexander's question, is there any species which doesn't contribute to the balance of life on Earth?
Well, I guess my knee-jerk response to that is every species does something. There's something out there that eats it. There's something out there that probably is parasitic on it. And there's something out there that it eats. So it's pretty much guaranteed that every species on the planet does something. That's why it's a species. It has its own unique niche.
Meet Ian Donoghue, Associate Professor in the Zoology Department in Trinity College, Dublin. He's an expert in the dynamics of ecosystems, but even experts don't know it all.
We, even as ecologists and scientists, might not be aware of why something is unique, the different jobs that it does, but it's there for a reason. This thing that makes it different is the reason that it's still around and it still exists.
So when we lose a species, how do we know what might happen when something goes extinct?
Honestly, the simplest answer to that is we don't, really. But we know that something will happen. Every species is connected in some way to every other species in an ecosystem. Not just the species that directly interact with it, like eat it, for example, or its own food, but also all of the other species that interact with those species. So the whole system feels the reverberating effects of the loss of a single species from a network.
So is there any way of understanding these complex networks or predicting the ripple effects of something going extinct? Well, you can try using a mathematical model, but these don't always tell the whole picture. There's no substitute for seeing what actually happens in the real world. What are the consequences when you remove particular species? In other words, simulate their extinction. To find out, Ian's developed field experiments, or rather, seashore experiments.
For me, I think the most exciting experiments that we've done have all been on coastal rocky shores. Very conveniently, a few kilometres from my own home here in North Dublin.
Oh, that's brilliant.
Yes, exactly, on the east coast of Ireland.
So what, during the pandemic, would you just sort of pop down every day and see what's going on?
Well, yeah, certainly once a week. So we have these little cages that we build on the shore. They're open wire mesh cages, so everything that's small enough to fit through the small apertures in the cages are able to get in. But our target species, which were different species of snails on the shore and also crabs and whelks, they're not able to come in or out. We're able to remove any species that we want to remove and simulate their extinction and then look at what happens to the entire communities then inside that cage.
Ian used this experiment to learn more about secondary extinctions, where the loss of one species leads to the loss of others. They tried taking crabs or whelks out, the top predators in this system, and compared that to the effect of taking out snails, which grazed on the algae. So this is exactly the kind of thing our listener Alexander was wondering about. Are some species less important than others at maintaining other lives in the system?
We found that when you remove either of the two predatory species that we looked at, when you remove dog whelks by themselves or when you remove crabs by themselves from the shore, we found that about one-third of the algal species also went extinct. But when you remove the grazing snails in this instance, we didn't find that they caused any secondary extinctions. They modified the structure of the algal communities, but no algal species actually went extinct.
Does that mean if you take a predator out, it still has more of an effect even though the whelks aren't eating the algae, right?
Exactly. They have this cascading effect throughout the system. The food of the whelk, the snails, started eating more. And because of that, the algal species that were particularly tasty, to the snails, they disappeared. So it just really highlights, I think, how species that are not directly connected to each other, their presence affects everything else in the system. One species that might be many, many links away in a network can have profound effects on the abundance and the presence or absence of other species in the system.
At the other end of the scale, are there some species that really don't matter quite so much? So, you know, they might go extinct and there aren't really knock-on effects.
I would say, well, what happens in the real world, of course, is extinctions are happening all the time, every day. Most of them are probably species that have never even been described. So we feel from here that these things are not important because they haven't changed the world. But over time, of course, their loss will have changed this system, maybe in ways that we haven't been able to measure. But every species does something unique. So the loss of any species from a system does have consequences.
And the consequence of extinction after extinction, like the planet is experiencing today, is an increasingly unstable system. Ian likens it to the game Jenga, a tower of wooden pieces you remove one by one.
You can remove one Jenga piece and it may have no effect. The system might look quite balanced and it mightn't have affected much. But if you keep removing, of course, that stack becomes less and less stable and is less and less likely to stay up. At the same time, if you have a full Jenga stack, there may be one piece that you remove that makes everything else fall down. And that's kind of how we view interaction networks. Some species are disproportionately important, but every species is also important. And if you keep losing species from the system, ultimately that Jenga stack is much, much less stable and much, much less likely to be able to persist over time.
As an ecologist, can I pick your brains about what would happen if one particularly invasive species, namely humans, decided that we'd put the keys back and leave Earth? What might happen to every other species?
Well, we probably wouldn't be able to hear their cheers from space, but I'd be pretty sure that if they could, they'd be cheering. I know, like anything, there are some species that benefit from the presence of humans. If you were an objective ecologist looking at the system, you would really look at the human population as a major problem because we're affecting every system on the planet with our waste and with the way we're changing the land to suit us. But at the same time, I genuinely think that there are ways that we can develop as society in ways that benefit nature. And what's really important to recognise, of course, is that we rely on nature. When we view it like that, I think we really need to have a central focus on how we can help to maintain the natural world and maintain biodiversity. Because ultimately, if we don't, we're impoverishing the natural world for our children and grandchildren and future generations.
It's a message we've heard over and over again in this show. Biodiversity is important. While I'll leave it to philosophers to determine the value of each life in itself, those lives are also important because a rich variety of species makes for a stable ecosystem. So, although we might not know as much about snails as we do about rhinos, say, or polar bears, the planet does need them. They're even useful in Alexander's garden, if he can pick them off his delicious plants and keep them in his compost heap.
That's all for this episode of CrowdScience from the BBC World Service. Today's question was from me, Alexander, in the UK. The show was presented by Marnie Chesterton and produced by Kathy Edwards. If you have a question about anything as big as the planet or as small as a snail, please send it to crowdscience@bbc.co.uk. Thanks for listening. Bye!